Hi, today we'll cover the last point of chapter number 12, that is disk management and swap space management. So in the previous lecture we saw how exactly the disks are arranged. So we saw the disk structure, how the different disks are arranged in the form of a cylinder inside the disk drive. So what are tracks, what are the sectors, what is bad sector and so on. So today we'll discuss the disk management, how exactly the disks are managed. So we know that whenever you buy a new disk, initially that disk will be blank, and usually that disk blank means it will be just a disk, it will not be having any partitions and all. So that's why whenever you buy a disk, so first you have to format that disk. You might have experienced this whenever you buy a new pen drive, and if you want to start using that pen drive, whenever you plug it onto a system, so in most of the time it will ask you to format that. So whenever you format that, so automatically whatever the data structures that are required in order to handle that device, so all those things will be loaded and you can start using that particular device. So in the same way, you consider any disk, the same approach is followed. So that's what the first process that comes for the disk management is the disk formatting. So whatever the discussion, whatever the thing I told you, it is nothing but the low level formatting, or it is also called as physical formatting. Whenever you perform this, it is going to divide a disk into the number of sectors that the disk controller can read and write. So that's what I told you, that in the previous lecture we saw the disk structure, and in that we saw how exactly the disk is divided into the number of sectors and tracks, so that you can perform the read and write operations very easily. So that's why in order to start using a disk, the first the disk formatting is to be done, and that is called as the low level formatting or the physical formatting, which is going to divide the single disk into the number of sectors and tracks. So that is nothing but the data structures that are required to handle that disk. So to use a disk to hold the files, the operating system still needs to record its own data structures on the disk, the same thing. So it requires the partition the disk into one or more groups of the cylinders, and the logical formatting or making a file system. So that's what the low level formatting or the physical formatting is going to divide the disk into the number of sectors and tracks. So in addition to that, the operating system should add the data structures into the partition so as to make use of that particular disk. So for that, again the logical formatting, or it is also called as making a file system, the name itself indicates. So as a result, it is going to add the data structures so as to create a file system on the disk, and through that file system it will be very easy to access the contents of that particular disk on the system. So to increase the efficiency, the most file systems group the blocks into the clusters so that the disk IO is done in terms of the blocks, and the file IO is done in terms of the cluster. So at the disk level we have the blocks, and at the file levels we have the clusters for the IO operation, in short. So after this, the next one is boot block. So we know that whenever you start your system, so there is something called the bootstrap program. So when you start your system, the first program that is executed is the bootstrap program. So I think this we already discussed in the process chapter. So usually this bootstrap program is stored on the ROM, and it is developed by the manufacturer only, so that the user cannot change this, because this is the essential code that is required to start your system, and if anything is modified in this, so your system itself cannot be started. So that's why this bootstrap program plays a very important role. So that's what whatever the part of the disk or the part of the memory that holds the bootstrap program. So it is nothing but a boot block. So this is going to initialize the system, and as I told you, it is usually stored in a separate ROM so that the user cannot change the content. So the third term comes here is the bad blocks. A bad block, a method such as the sector sparing is used to handle the bad block. So I think while discussing the disk structure itself, I have told you about this bad block. So bad block means it is nothing but whenever a particular sector or the part of the disk is damaged, so that is of no use. So in that case, there is a provision to change one particular disk instead of changing the assembly itself. So again, in addition to that, means before replacement, again there are some methods like the sector sparing and so on, which can be used to handle the bad blocks. So that's what we saw, that the boot block contains the bootstrap program which is required to initialize your computer system. So here we have an example of booting from a disk in the Windows 2000 system, and you can see here as we know, the disk part is itself is divided into the number of partitions. So here you can see the partitions, like partition 1, 2, 3, 4, so on, the number of partitions will be there. But in addition to this, here you can see there is a small space of memory on the disk, that is a separate partition you can consider, but this is for the system. The system is automatically going to create this partition, and this is called as the MBR, that is master boot record. So whatever initially the system is initialized by using the bootstrap program. So after that bootstrap program, the operating system should be loaded. So where that location or the information necessary to load the operating system is present, that is present here, that is in MBR. So that's why again this is independent of the different partitions. So this MBR is again having these two things, that is boot code and the partition table. So this itself is nothing but a boot partition. So here it is shown something like this, means actual code may be present here, and the information related to this is present in this MBR. So this is about the disk management. So next point we'll discuss is about the swap space management. So the swap space management is a low level task of the operating system, and we know that the virtual memory is used on the system, and usually the virtual memory is used on the disk space as an extension of the main memory. So that's why I think in the previous lecture we saw that the virtual memory resides between the main memory and the secondary memory, and the main use of virtual memory is to speed up the system or to increase the performance of your system. So here we'll see how exactly that virtual memory is again related to this swap space itself. So what is this swap space? So the swap space is again, it's a part of the memory that is used by the operating system. And for instance, the systems that implement the swapping may use the swap space to hold an entire process image, including the code and the data segments. So the swap space, the memory, the virtual memory uses the disk space as an extension of the main memory that we discussed. The swap space can be again where it is implemented. So it may be implemented out of a normal file system, or it may be commonly implemented on a separate disk partition. So whenever it is implemented on a normal file system, so whatever the APIs or the commands that we use to handle the normal files, they all are applicable for this swap space management or the swap space on the normal file system. But in the other case, whenever it is implemented on a separate partition, that is disk partition, so in order to handle in this case, so there may be again some separate program that may be required to handle the swap space if it is implemented on the separate disk partition. So here we have some examples like the swap space management on 4.3 BSD Linux allocates the swap space when process starts and holds the text segment and the data segment. So here kernel uses some approach that is swap maps to track swap space use. One more system that is Solaris 2 allocates the swap space only when a page is forced out of physical memory and not when the virtual page is first created. So this is just the example on how the on different machines the swap space is managed. So these are the data structures for swapping on the Linux system, that is whatever the example we saw. So again it depends where you have implemented this swap, whether you have implemented on a separate on a file system or on a separate partition. So that's what here, this is the swap area, and here we have the page slots, and we have a one-to-one mapping between the page slot and the swap map. So in this way, the swap space can be managed. Thank you.